Here are some high-level languages. In other words, they're fancy as f***. But how much of one can you get rid of and still be capable of doing whatever you want? Let's start by defining that. What all of these languages have in common is Turing completeness, which in simple terms means they can theoretically do any computation given enough time and memory. That just means they let us do whatever we want as long as we have a buff computer. So, what's the least you need to do anything? As long as you have booleans, enough of them can represent any data, so fancy data types can go. We also don't need functions because code can be repeated. Input and output operations are also unnecessary since the interpreter could read and write to the disk directly. Turns out, as long as you have booleans, memory to store them, logic gates to perform computation, and a bit of control flow, you can do anything. That's still too fancy for me. With just logic gates and binary, we have what is known as a functionally complete system. That means you can write any program you want for any given input size. This input size is an important limitation. Say you want to make a text-to-brain converter. A functionally complete system will let you make a separate program for every x-bit input, whereas a Turing-complete system will let you make one program which takes any input size. However, for binary, this limitation only exists because of how we're writing code, that is, linearly. We write lines of code one after the other and they're run in order. But what if we didn't? What if instead we just made a graph? Each node would represent a logic gate, would take inputs from some nodes, and pass their outputs to other nodes. The advantage of this is that you can make circle. And thus we could create a makeshift register. In this system, a value on a line doesn't change until something around it changes, so we can keep some values as memory and modify them over time. Now, we only need to take one Boolean input, use that to modify register values, and only then accept another input. We've simulated memory using logic gates, and control flow can be done by abusing the updating mechanic I mentioned. Now, we only need logic gates and Booleans. When it comes to these logic gates, you have the NOT gate and then the 16 binary gates. But you don't actually need all of that. Look at this NOR gate right next to the subscribe button that you should probably click on. It takes two binary inputs and returns true only if both inputs are false. Since A or B returns false only if both inputs are false, then NOT A or B would have the same result as NOR. Additionally, since A and B returns true only if both inputs are true, then by applying NOT to each input before passing it to AND would also be equivalent to NOR. This means that anytime we see NOR, we can swap it with one of these two without changing the end result. Take a look at what happens when we pass the same value twice to NOR. You get the opposite of the inputs. In other words, A nor A will be the same as just not A. If we use either of the above replacements of nor, we can simplify everything away and confirm that we are left with just not A. Next up, since nor returns true only if both inputs are false, then the complete opposite gate would return false only if both inputs are false. This truth table looks eerily similar to the OR gate, so we can define OR as being not the quantity A nor B. Finally, we see that the truth table of the AND gate is a symmetrical flip of NOR. Thus, by applying NOT to each input before sending it to NOR, we find that the AND gate is simply not A nor not B. Since every other logic gate is defined with AND, OR, and NOT, we can now simulate all 17 logic gates with just NOR. Now we're left with Booleans and the NOR gate, and that's about as far as we can go. I think that's pretty fascinating. Anyways, thanks for watching.